Start with the name of Allah, the most merciful and grateful. Dear students of class Akhneer, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome you in Pakistan International School Types Virtual Learning System. Hope you are doing well. Dear students, we have English lecture number 15 of grade second year today, and this is unit 3. And we are going to learn today the reading selection 3.2, as the name of reading selection 3.2 is Linguin Gorge. Linguin Gorge is on page number 94-100, and here's your teacher, Sarfaz Nadeem. Dear students, as you are well aware that in yesterday's lecture, we completed our reading selection 3.1, the lesson of lesson from the Battle of Uhud. So today we have another selection 3.2 and Linguin Gorge. Rereading of Linguin Gorge is here that the narrator of the essay is on his way to reach the site of his job, but cold and snow detain him, and he meets a little kid looking after his little sister while his parents are working down below them in the mountains. Though very sleepy, the little kid refuses to go to sleep. Hearing what the little kid says, the narrator at once jumps to his feet and gets ready to reach the place of his duty. Why he did so, and what do you think the little kid said to him? This is all in our story, in our reading selection. So let us start our reading. Here is the, dear students, reading selection 3.2, and this is about on page number 94. If you open your book, you can easily check it. We are here on page number 94. Dear students, we have the topic Linguin Gorge. A man should never leave his post. To Peng Cheng. The snow already more than half a foot deep obliterated the line between earth and sky behind a hazy white curtain. I had been following the path of the future railway for 40 kilometers. Although I could hear the roar of machinery further back in the hills, I had seen neither work sites nor workers. Dear students, here the narrator is just going on his duty, and in his way, he is just hearing the roar of machinery and further back in the hills, but he didn't see any worker or any work. Entering Linguin Gorge, my irritation increased even in clear weather. In this gorge, the sun never shone. It didn't matter where you looked up along the twisting course. The most you could see of the sky was a patch no bigger than the palm of your hand. Now it was dust and the swirling snowflakes and the gale made every step a struggle. Now, dear students, he is telling in this paragraph that when I entered in Linguin Gorge, my irritation increased even in clear weather. In this gorge, the sun never shone. Means that gorge was so narrow and you are not supposed to see your sun clear, and patch was not bigger and very narrow and palm your hand. So it was dusk and swirling snowflakes the gale made. Construction in the gorge was very busy. Everywhere people were at work, generators, cement mixers, air compressors, shook the ground. Now here he's telling us about that the work is in progress, and hundreds of light bulbs gleam dim and yellow, electric wires crisscrossing like a giant spider web were scarcely visible, but I could see the overhead cables and their pulley cars sliding back and forth, loaded with materials. And he's saying that now I can see that the generator, I can hear very easily, and generators, cement mixers, and air compressors voice. And also he saw that hundreds of light bulbs gleamed dim and yellow, and electric wires were crisscrossing, and I could see the overhead cables, their pulley cars sliding. They are just going to take the material from one place to another place. Hungry, cold, I tripped and fell, scraping my hands. Enough, I'll find some place under a cliff out of the wind and rest a few hours. If I reached the materials depot tomorrow morning by 10 o'clock, that still wouldn't be too late. Stumbling around in the dark like this, I was liable to fall into some deep vine, and that would be the end of this materials department chief. I would have to be put on the used up list. Now, dear students, here he is talking about that he was hungry, feeling cold, and he thought that I tripped and fell. So it was difficult for him to move further, and he thought that I must take a rest under a cliff, out of the wind as well, and rest few hours. And he thought that if I will be able to reach a depot tomorrow morning by 10 o'clock, it would be not so late for me. So that's why he decided to take a rest where he can find a good place. So he was thinking about that. I was liable to fall into some deep ravine, and that would be the end of this materials department chief. I would have to be put on the used to list. So he thought that it's better for me to rest, because weather was not allowing him to move further. It was difficult for him to move. That's why he decided to take a rest for a while. Now, I noticed a path leading to a cave in the cliffside. A door curtain hanging in the entrance way showed that the cave was undoubtedly occupied by workers grasping branches along the steep path. Here now, dear students, is telling us that I noticed a path, means he saw a way going to cave in the cave. And he also saw the curtain hanging in the door entrance, but showed that the cave was undoubtedly occupied by workers. Now he thought that there is a cave, there is a safe place, or there is a kind of place where the workers are getting a rest, or might that is a home of the workers. And also the steep path was there, and the way was going over there to this path. And he decided the way is going over there, so and to steep one. I hauled myself up to the other door, up to the door, and entered. Here the word is howl means that he pushed himself to go further. In other words, he took himself to enter over there. Strange, seated on a small stool in the doorway, was a little boy, seven or eight years old, elbows in his knees, supporting his face in his hands. His cheeks were red. Now, dear students, when he entered in that cave, he becomes strange, and he saw that a 7 to 8 years old boy was just sitting over there. in the doorway and supporting his face in his hands. Means he was just sitting just like he was waiting for someone. And it was a very strange thing for the writer. His cheeks, yes, his cheeks were red with cold. He had been peering at the opposite cliff side through a rent in the curtain. He glanced at me briefly as I came in, then went back to his observation. He said that his cheeks were cold due to were red due to cold, and he had been peering at the opposite cliff side through a rent in the curtain. He was just watching, he was just seeing and watching somewhere, and then he saw me, and he went back and sat over there. The cave was large but quite warm. It had a stove. Yes, now he's saying that the cave was large but quite warm. So it had a stove and eating utensils on the wall above a bed was a colored New Year picture of chubby children pulling the turnip. All the walls had been prepared with old newspapers, now blackened by smoke from the stove. This one is saying that the cave was large but quite warm. It had a stove and eating utensils. So he's just telling us the situation, the location of the inner cave, and the newspapers were pasted over on the walls, and they were now blacked by the stove. Why isn't anybody home? I asked, shaking the snow from my coat and hat. The little boy turned his head. His eyes flashed. Aren't I anybody, Uncle? He rose and walked towards me, his hands behind his back, his chest extended as if to say, not only am I somebody, I'm a very grown-up somebody. I cupped his round little face in my hands. You are pretty sharp, young him. Hey, students, him means a kind of naughty, mischievous child. He pushed my hands aside, doubling up his fists. He cocked his head to one side and demanded, who are you calling him? I have a name, pointing at the baby girl asleep on the bed. He informed me, her name is Pao Cheng. Mine is Cheng Yu, no doubt about it. These kids were like thousands of others I had met, born and raised on construction sites. The workers liked to name their children after the projects where they were born. Cheng Yu probably had first seen the light of day on the railway project between Chengdu and Chongqing, also known as Yu. His baby sister Pao Cheng very likely had been born right here at the site of the future Pakai Chengdu Railway. Now, dear students, here the boy said that I'm a young man, I'm a body in the home. How can you say that nobody is at home? And he said that my sister is sleeping, you just don't talk so loud like this. And his name was because the workers who were just living over there on the work site, when they had a baby, they just put the name of the same about your project. I sat by the stove smoking and rubbing the drying mud from my hands. Cheng Yu crawled onto my lap and looked into my eyes. Is it going to snow tomorrow, uncle? I praised his icy red little nose. As soon as we get a telephone line connected up with heaven, I'll ask for you. Angrily, he leaped down and stood a meter away, scowling at me. Quite you kidding? You've got a newspaper in your pocket. Why don't you look at the newspaper report, at the weather report? He resumed his seat in the doorway, clamped his elbows on his knees, rested his face in his hands, and peered out through the rent in the curtain. When I asked him where the kettle was, he ignored me. I certainly was sorry I had offended my small host. Why do you want to know about the snow, Chang Yu? I asked him. Is it because you can't go out and play when it's snowing? He didn't even bother to look at me. Papa says if it's still snowing tomorrow, we will have to quit work. So here, dear students, in this situation, boy was quite young and he seems that he is older than his age and he had a very good behavior and attitude. In other words, when he asked to the narrator that, will it be snow tomorrow? Then he answers in a funny mood, but he said, well, you have a pocket. You have a newspaper in your pocket. You can see it. And then the narrator felt that he becomes angry. So he went over there and asked, why you want to ask? Do you want to play? He said, no, because my father said, if there is a snow tomorrow, we'll have to quit work. Means we will leave work and we will just enjoy life. What does your pa do? He opens up mountains, the child replied proudly, where Cheng Yu pointed with pursed lips at the work site opposite. I looked, all I could see was a searching light beam shining through the drifting snowflakes straight up into the heavens. In its light, I could visually discern a few dozen men who seemed posted to the side of the towering cliff, drilling holes for dynamite charges. The holes were like to the steps of a ladder to the sky. How can you tell which one is your father at this distance? I asked. I can't see him plainly, but Pa says he can see me. He says all he has to do is turn around. I often sit here so he can see me. Now, dear students, in this paragraph, when the narrator asks from the boy that what does your pa do, and he just replied proudly and pointed opposite the side, there was work in progress and people were doing work, and he said that my father is over there. And again the narrator asks, where is your father? How can you see him? He said, my father said that you can't see me, but he is watching me clearly. Oh, so that was it. The icy snow melted from my boots, my numb legs thawing out ached painfully. I stamped to help the circulation. Cheng Yu waved his hand warningly. I understood he was afraid I would wake his baby sister. You really take good care of your sister. I commend it. Mama says my job is to look after her. When Mama comes home, I can knock off. Now, dear students, here when the narrator was trying to make a noise, and the Cheng Yu waved his hand warningly, and he said that please don't make noise or any voice, because her sister, baby sister, was sleeping. And he's asking you taking good care. He said, yes, my mom said it's my job. So you are on the job every day. I hugged him. What does mama do? He pointed to the road below the camp. I could see a person standing by a telephone pole beside the road. covered with snow, she looked like a white stone match. Apparently, she was directing traffic. The road, not very wide, had been blasted through the rock. Ordinarily, that road, 20 mules, donkeys, and people, no doubt, steamed in both directions along that road 24 hours a day. Someone had to keep the traffic in order. It means her mom was just directing the traffic. She was doing the job of the traffic. Today, because of the big snow, there weren't many people or vehicles on the road. She couldn't very well have spent the day at home, but there she stood, and there she would remain 3 months, 5 months, or 3 years, 5 years if need be, perhaps from time to. Now he's telling the student that she was working over there on the road, and if they need time, she's there. Time. She raised her head to gaze up to her, at her child or at her husband, who was scaling the cliffs between the mountains and the sky. When he paused to wipe the sweat from his brow, could he see the determined figure of his wife or the tiny image of for his little boy? Even though it was a snowy, windy night, even though the worker, his little boy, wife, and children couldn't see one another clearly, I was sure they could feel a mutual loving encouragement and sense that each was looking forward to the moment of family reunion. Now, dear students, means the mom was working over there at the traffic directions, and father was working over there scaling the cliff, and the boy baby was at home, and there were three people were just watching each other, but not clearly, but they were feeling their mutual love and encouragement, the sense of each other, and they were just working their jobs. I glanced at Ching Yu. The child had placed his hands in his sleeves and pulled his neck into his collar. He kept dozing off. "You're liable to catch chill. Better get into bed and go to sleep." He looked at me dreamily for a moment, probably thinking that his parents had returned. When he realized who I was, he shook his head violently. "No, I won't. Why not?" He rubbed his eyes with his fist. "Papa and Mama say a man should never leave his post." Now, dear students, the boy was feeling sleepy. And when the narrator said that, yes, you can sleep also because your baby is sleeping and you can get sleep over there, he rubbed his eyes with his fist. "Papa and Mama say a man should never leave his post." He said that my mother and father said that a man should never leave his post. "Oh, this is my post. This is my job. I cannot leave it." I hugged him tightly and pressed my cheek against his. Then I rose, buttoned my coat, pulled my hat down firmly, left the cave and walked down the path, following the road that had been blasted through the rock. I pushed on the words of the child, echoing in my head, "A man should never leave his post. A job was waiting for me. I wanted to reach my destination without any further delay." These words really put a home in his heart, and he just put his hat and he went out to take his coat. He saw whatever the path, whatever the way, whatever the road is difficult, he has to reach on his duty. A man should never leave his post. So this is the lesson, dear students. And the main theme is that a man should not leave his post. And what is the summary? Summary is that this story teaches the sense of duty and the devotion of a nation. And he's saying that it is for everyone that a man should firm his duty and do his duty with core of his heart. Dear students, we have here about the author. After growing up in a poor family in the province of Shenzi, also spelled Shenzi, Tu Peng Cheng, born in 1921, worked as a correspondent for the New China News during China's civil war in the late 1940s. His many notes about battles he witnessed became important sources for his later fiction, including his acclaimed war novel Defan Yun, published in 1954. Winning praise throughout China for his depiction of military life, Tu enjoyed a flourishing career throughout the 1950s. In 1950, he published his next major novel in peacetime, which describes workers constructing the Pak to Chengdu, Baojai to Chengdu railway. Tu fell from favor in the 1960s when the government rewrote his history and condemned several former leaders whom Tu had praised in his fiction. His work was banned in China until 1978, when a thaw in the nation's totalitarian regime allowed to resume his writing career. Dear students, and it was banned in 1978 for his working. His name is very well known, and he was a Chinese worker officer working over there. This is the introduction about the author, dear students. We have a new vocabulary, dear students, on page number 98. The difficult words are given over and their meaning. Dusk, twilight, or the darker. This is all about. And then we have, dear students, recalling. In recalling, we have questions. First questions you can see over here, dear students. And I think it would be easy for you to write. Yes, question number one is, what is the narrator's job and the purpose of his journey? What physical condition persuaded him to rest for a few hours? Very easy. The narrator is the chief of the material department. The purpose of his journey is to reach the material department and to check the progress of work being done there. The weather is terrible and he is hungry. It is dark and the swirling snowflakes and the cold wind make every step difficult for him. These conditions persuade him to rest a few hours. So this is the student recalling, and we have interpreting as well. You can write answers by yourself very well, and inshallah, my help is there. If any query, any problem, I'm at Zoom. You can ask me anytime in group as well. Dear students, we have another topic, the use of the tenses. The use of tenses, I think very easy for everyone, because dear students, the tenses are basic for the English, and if you have a grip on it, you can do it very, very good. Like you can write essay, paragraph, or translation, you can do very well. You can write dialogue. It's very important for every student to be a master over in this skill in the tenses. So we have, you know very well the translation is where we have. And we have dialogues as well, paragraphs in this first, second year. Essay we have in class second year. So I think the use of tense is very important. So have a bit look over there. I tried my level best to make you understand to what are the tenses. You know very well from the beginnings we are learning over here, but still this is a kind of revision. Use of the tenses. The verbs come in three tenses, past, present, and future. The past is used to describe things that have already happened, like earlier in the day, yesterday, last week, 3 years ago. The present tense is used to describe things that are happening right now or things that are continuous. The future tense describes things that have yet to happen. Later, tomorrow, next week, next year. So here, dear students, basically we have three tenses, present, past, and future. Past is used to describe things that have already happened, like earlier in the day. And dear students, last week, yesterday. And the present tense is used to describe things that are happening right now, are things that are continuous. And the future definitely is describing things that have to yet to happen, like tomorrow, later, next week. So these are basic tenses. We have three, present, past, future. Then we have kinds of these tenses. Let's start to look at them. We have look over there. The simple present is used to express a habitual action as I read nearly every day or he takes milk every morning. Means any action which is going to every day, it's a habitual. If you use the simple present in this. The present continuous used for an action going on at the speaking or at the time of speaking, the action was in progress. Like I am reading Shakespeare at the moment, means now he is reading the Shakespeare, or the boys are playing hockey. For an action that is planned, now dear students, you understood that the action which is in progress, that is present continuous tense. For an action that is planned to arrange to take place in the future, it is also the present continuous tense also used to arrange to take place the plan in future. Like I'm going to the cinema tonight, my uncle is arriving tomorrow. So we use the present continuous for future as well, but when we have a planning something, we already planned. Present perfect is used to indicate completed activities in the immediate past. Like I have read so many books. I have read so many books. I can't keep count, or he has just gone out. Now in present perfect, dear students, completed activity in the immediate past means any action which we have completed, no more left to do. It has done, in other words. And present perfect continuous is used for an activity which began at some time in the past and is still continue. Means any action which started past and is still in progress called present perfect continuous tense. Like I have been reading since I was 4 years old. Means still he is no more 4 years old, but still he is reading. The action started in the 4 years old when he was, now he is 19 years old, 20 years old, still he is reading. So the action is started in the past and still is in progress is called present perfect continuous tense. They have been sleeping for 5 hours and is still sleeping. Means, dear students, they started to sleep 5 hours ago and still 5 hours finished, completed, and still they are sleeping. It means that is the present perfect continuous tense. Like you can say, I have been living here in KSA since 2009, 5, 2000, or 4, 30 years. Dear students, here in this tense, we use since and for. And you are well aware that since is used when we have particular time, like since 2 o'clock, you know very well that since 3 days, 2 days, you know, since Saturday, since Monday, like this. But if you don't know the specific time, particular time, then you use for 5 years. I have been working in KSA for five years. I have been watching the program for 2 hours. Means you don't know exactly time. That's why you are using the for. And if you know the exactly time, you use the since. Here we have, dear students, the simple view of the old tenses. Now, simple past. Simple past, in this tense, we use the second form of verb. Like last night, I read an entire novel. This is the just like last night, means the time has went past and he completes. So, second form is verb is used. I read an entire novel. Past continuous is same like present continuous means the work is in progress right now, but the past continuous means work was in progress. Like I was reading. So I was reading means he was reading at that time. So I was reading the novel last night. So means last night he was reading at that time. I had read at least 100 books by the time I was 12. Past perfect tense, dear students, means action which we completed much time ago. I had read at last 100 books by the time I was 12. Means 12, when he was 12 years old, he had read these books. So here we use had. And here we use was reading, was watching. Past perfect continuous, I had been reading for at least a year before my sister learned to read. So he's saying that I had been reading for at least a year before my sister learned to read. So he had completed his work earlier, action which was in much past. Simple future means any action which is supposed to be done in coming time, like I will read as much as I can this year. Means coming time, he will try to will and shall are helping verbs. Future continuous, I will be reading national anthem soon, like, and future perfect, I will have read at least 500 books by the end of the year. Now he is future planning, like I will have to. Means it's still the time not come yet, but he is planning that I will have read at least 500 books. And future perfect continuous, I will have been reading for at least 2 hours before dinner tonight. Means he is saying that future perfect continuous means an action which we have to start in the past. Will have been reading for at least 2 hours before dinner. Means still dinner time didn't come. But he has planned it. I will have been reading for at least 2 hours before dinner tonight. So dear students, this is all about the use of the tenses. Basically, we have three tenses, present, past, and future. Then we have kinds. Each tense like contains four kinds, four of present and four kinds of the past and four same for the future. So total 12 we have. So this is the basic grammar, dear students of class second year. It's a very important for all of you. This is in your book as well. You can easily check in your book. And tenses are on the page number in the previous lesson. Yes, I will help you to tell you that these are on the page number 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, and then we have a few exercises on page number 89 and 90 and 91. You must complete these exercises and send it to me by WhatsApp. This is a very important topic, and this is all about today's lecture, dear students. And thank you for joining, and see you in tomorrow inshallah, next lecture. And till that, Allah Hafiz and goodbye.